Hello, welcome to Rational Investing. My name is Cameron Stewart, CFA. Thank you very much for watching. I greatly appreciate the support, comments, and subscription. This channel is dedicated to the rational investor, and here we're looking for businesses' intrinsic value based on cash flow. We look for a business that has five key attributes: top-line revenue growth, earnings growth, as we define by EBITDA, free cash flow growth, solid balance sheet, and a well-priced stock. Those five attributes to us give us confidence that a forecast will happen over long term and we will realize the economic value, which is the difference between the intrinsic value and the market price. As that shrinks, we realize that return and we try to find businesses that we believe in the forecast is simple, conservative, and executable to give us that return. Today, we're going to look at Boeing. All right, Boeing's been in the news recently, obviously, because the airlines have cratered. Airline demand has fallen because of COVID. And it's really unsure what's going to go on. Boeing's had some problems last year when the 737 was actually shelved due to software problems. And then on top of that, after they actually got clearance to start production again, COVID hits. And now people are unsure about airline traffic demand. You know, are people going to be flying the same amount as before? Traffic demand was going up very, very nicely for a long period of time. And now people are suddenly thinking, well, maybe they're going to work from home and just video chat. And what does that do to the number of bodies in airplanes flying around the globe? And in turn, what does that do to aircraft demand, of which Boeing makes a ton of them? So let's take a look at that first. Kind of get our minds around where we think airline demand might go. Then we'll look at the financials, then we'll forecast, and then we'll look at the economic return. So it's kind of a number of steps. I'm going to try to go quickly and move through this. Thank you for watching. Let's look at the most recent performance guidance they have given us. Now, Boeing has actually raised new debt to help bridge themselves over some period of time, and they've issued some new, not guidance, but just kind of a recap. And what I want to go, this is the Q1 2020 performance review that Boeing issued in March. And what I want to focus on is two slides. One, this bottom slide, right? This is passenger traffic outlook. I don't know if I can make this big enough that you can actually see it here. I think you can read that. So this is 2010, 2020. They zoomed out and gave you a multi-decade look, I think, to say that based on history, it must revert to the mean. That's basically what they're saying here. Giant cratering. And then, oh, there's your V-shaped recovery, and we're going to go on our merry way. I'm not so sure of this, frankly. And I think that if you're going to put your money to work, the stock better be well discounted to make warrant the risk that happens. Because if it drops down and stays here for a long time, that is a significant drop in demand for Boeing aircraft, and the stock price is going to hurt as a result of it. So I think the market is assuming this guidance. Let's take a look at the rest of it. If we go down, I think they give us here the breakdown of the business. So this is interesting. Frankly, I didn't know this. I thought Boeing had a whole lot more commercial aviation than they actually do. The defense industry, obviously I knew it was there. I didn't know it was 34% of their business. That's nice. So commercial aviation's 42% of their business. So we're talking about a drop on 42% of their business, not 70, 80, 90%. Like, Delta, Southwest, the airlines themselves, right? That's 100% of their business is air travel. At least here, they're feeding planes into a system that's declined. Then that feed rate is 40% of revenue. All right, so we just did that. Let's go take a look now at the financials. Behind me is 9 years of financials data for Boeing. Looking historically, it's very difficult for us to figure out where it's going to go. So I'm basically going to average a lot here and then string it out in the future and see if I can't buy something at a reasonable enough price to give me enough upside to where I get to keep the upside and I'm not paying too much for it. That's the way I'm gonna look at this. You can see that they've actually grew their revenue, but for the last year when they had to shut down the manufacturing of the plane, they were growing quite nicely. $68 billion up to $101 billion. pretty, very, very nice growth. This last year, they kind of cratered because of that shutdown. So it's really an idea of where they're gonna go, I'm not sure. And I'm just gonna have to really guess at this one and then hopefully price it low enough to make the economics worth the upside for me. EBIT, add depreciation gives me EBITDA. It looks like 2 years ago, in 18, they really peaked. 100 billion of revenue, 14 billion of EBITDA. This is like the economy on steroids, right? Every 2018, everything was going gangbusters. I don't think that's gonna happen going forward. I think air traffic's gonna be more tempered. I think business environment has become more difficult to operate into. So I'm not sure if I would peg that as the go forward. I actually end up averaging a little bit in here, but we'll keep going. I'm gonna take a look at the rest of the business first, then we'll update. Debt's been pretty flat. I'll get to the update in a second, but you can see 37 billion to 36 billion started ramping up here recently. On the market multiple, so here I'm taking the enterprise value. So to recap, I've got outstanding debt. They don't have any excess cash. Market cap, that's shares outstanding times price. Add all that up, I get enterprise value. And enterprise value has grown with the shares. And that growth is driven a lot by, well, mainly by earnings, right? That EBITDA that has ballooned up, it's driving the market cap up. The problem is if they peaked at 14 billion, they're now facing kind of the retooling of the 737, and then they have got to get air traffic demand. They're not going to hit 14 billion anytime soon. So it's really a matter of, you know, how much you paying for the company today. Debt looked okay. I mean, coming into the financial crisis, they were actually well positioned with very little debt. 2.6 times debt is low, and it's where we want to see it from a protection standpoint. All right, so that's a very fast overview of their financial position. All in all, they were doing very well coming into the shutdown of the airplanes and then into COVID. Now let's update. All right, so if you read down below, they did a large bond issuing for $25 billion here a month ago. They tried to go out for actually 10 to 15 billion is what they were estimating that they wanted. The demand for their debt was so large that they upsized it by $10 billion and went to $25 billion just to give them an obscene amount of cash. And some of that debt is 10-year debt at 5%. So I think what this is saying is these are investors diving in for a small yield on a relatively safe company. They feel it's not gonna go out of business. The government would step in and bail them out for the defense contractor anyways. So these investors are essentially protecting your equity investment, which is nice to see. And has given Boeing $15 billion of cash on hand in March Q to be able to weather whatever storm it's gonna take them to get airplane demand back up and running, which is great to see. It's a great cushion. It's certainly a long runway to give them to come back to a stabilized or a growth mode. What it's going to do, however, it's gonna take up free cash flow. So they're gonna have to pay that debt back. So what I'm doing is I'm gonna assume they're gonna pay a lot of that back within 5 years, and then cash flow will return back to kind of a normal rate that they can grow, and we'll see what that economic looks like. So what I've done here, as I said, the average EBITDA prior to the peak, kind of the entire time, was 9.5 billion. So I said, I don't know where they're gonna fall, where they're gonna end up kind of stabilizing with all of this, but I'm gonna say that they're gonna make roughly 9.5 billion over the next couple years as they figure this out. If they wanna get back to a normalized debt level, their average debt was 3.8 times debt. That is a total debt of $36 billion of maximum debt. That they currently have, with the $25 billion that they borrowed plus some other stuff that they had acquired before that, they have $62 billion. So that's a lot, that's a big difference. They need to go from $62 billion now, they have to buy that down over time back to a normalized level of 36. That's a $26 billion pay down, and that pay down is gonna come over the next 5 years. That's my assumption. 5 years, they're gonna chunk it down to get them to de-lever the company. So that means that that's $5.3 billion annually that they have to come out of pocket with to chunk that debt down. That comes out of free cash flow that could have been used to buy back shares, and it could have been used to pay dividends. So you have to take that into account. Now, what we're doing here is averaging the cash flow from operations that they average over the same period of time. Average CapEx, that gives me kind of a cash flow, if you will, after CapEx averaging over the last roughly decade. The debt payment we discussed earlier, and that means after CapEx, after debt service, Boeing will have $2.3 billion of cash available for shareholders. Shares outstanding, 565 million. That means cash flow for equity per share is $4. Okay, now we're going to use this in our cash flow statement. Let's go back up. We'll review quickly cash flow and go through, and then we'll forecast based on the number I just gave you. So cash flow from operations was actually very solid. Much like revenue growth, much like earnings growth, cash flow was growing solidly and in the same direction, in the same rate prior to the decline as EBITDA. So I think that represents well. They have plenty of free cash flow to cover the CapEx that they invest in. So cash flow of the business is strong. Debt was very reasonable, as we discussed earlier. Not too large, not too small, it's fine. So it produced a solid free cash flow to equity with a monster spike recently when they hit the 100 billion of revenue and 14 billion of EBITDA. That produced a tremendous amount of cash flow that they used to buy back shares and to dividend out to shareholders. And that's why the stock ballooned to 300 plus in the stock price was this monster year. Shares outstanding, they've decreased these over time 3%. That is a healthy payback rate. We like to see that. Cash flow to equity, shares, yield, strong yield, right? So yield, I'm taking free cash flow to equity per share divided by share outstanding to give me a yield on that cash. And that's a strong cash flow yield. Okay, now what? Let's review our criteria. Before we stretch this forward, let's review. Earnings growth. I gotta say yes, despite the recent decline, earnings growth is there with the caveat that the recent pandemic, the shortfall of the software may have produced a buying opportunity. So I'll give it a yes on the revenue. Earnings growth, yes. Strong fee cash flow, yes. Balance sheet, balance sheet's iffy. So I'm gonna look for a little higher return because they've levered up. That's gonna reduce our economic return as they pay that down. I like the stock. I'd be willing to go past it because of the, you know, if it's just have, it just has the one fault out of the five. Okay, let's see what the pricing is, what the return is. We'll make the final call. Let's stretch this forward. All right, so here's the cash flow forecast, and here's the value for the stock in 10 years based on that forecast. And what you're seeing here is we discussed earlier. This is the cash flow after making those debt payments for 5 years, and that's a conservative forecast, right? The sum of the debt, not all the $25 billion, but some of the $25 billion was 10-year amortizing notes. So me saying they're gonna pay it back in five is an aggressive assumption, and I wanna punish the cash flows to make sure that I'm not paying for kind of upside. I want something I know that Boeing can nail, so I have confidence that the number that I'm putting out there is gonna work. Or outperform, right? That's what you want. I don't want to underperform. So I'm pegging 4.09 as a shareholder, as a cash flow per share. I'm saying that it's going to hold flat for a couple years as they kind of figure out what went wrong, as air travel stabilizes, as the airplanes that have been grounded, if they get sucked back up into service, and then eventually start reordering planes. But because that's only 42% of the business, they can still grow aerospace, they can still grow defense. There's a lot of other growth there. So I'm applying a growth rate to this earnings, to this cash flow, despite still being a lower than optimal cash flow. Once they've paid off the $25 billion, well then that debt service, that $5 billion a year that they were chunking down on the debt, frees up and it suddenly gets back to the shareholders. So I go from $5 a share to $15 a share overnight because I've paid off the debt. Boom, I got a huge run. I continue my growth rate because the rest of the business is continuing to grow. It was just that I had to make the debt payment. Now the debt's gone. All that cash comes to the investors. I'm out 10 years for roughly $18 per share. I give the yield that you saw earlier, and I get a $360 price target in a decade. Okay? Let's take a look at EBITDA. EBITDA is kind of the same logic. Again, I'm pulling that average over time of $9 billion, $9.5 billion. I don't know where they're going to fall. It is a guess. But I'm trying to play it as conservatively as possible. And if the numbers work with a conservative investment, then I get to keep the upside. Essentially, I'm not paying too much for growth. I'm buying it in a very realistic expectation. I hold that for flat for 2 years. And then I say, you can continue to grow. And I grow at the same rate I grew cash flow. I'm growing the EBITDA. Here, I'm applying a 15 times multiple. This enterprise value to EBITDA multiple here gets distorted because of the negative EBITDA. So I just skipped that and I said, Boeing, its size, its growth. And I looked at kind of this average enterprise value to EBITDA range here was 15 times. I gave it a 15 times EBITDA. So I'm saying $236 billion is the enterprise value in a decade, less a normalized amount of debt for them, 3.8 times EBITDA. No excess cash. Market value of $183 billion, less outstanding shares. I'm not buying back shares. They're gonna have to spend the money to buy down the debt. I said conservatively leave the shares share price alone. You could actually say in maybe 5 to 10 years they buy back a little share, but I left it alone. Produces a share price of $323. Let's go look and see what this looks like in IRRs. So current price, $173. It's definitely come up recently. I'm weight averaging the two stock price. So I've got $358 from the free cash flow method. I've got $332 from the EBITDA multiple. Just have them, $341 a share. This is our gap that we're trying to close over time to realize the return. IRR. Buying it $173, I get cash flows over time. I get out at $341. I get an IRR of 12%. Now that's actually a pretty solid return for a defensive stock, no pun intended, like Boeing, and to have a double digit IRR is a very attractive entrance point for Boeing. And you're gonna make 2.6% of your business, 2.6 cash on cash return on a business, which the bondholders essentially backstopped you by giving them cheap debt, begging Boeing, not even essentially, they begged Boeing to take the money. That's what oversubscribed means. They asked for 10, they got demand for 25, everybody wants. So those guys are there to supply capital to ensure that Boeing continues to succeed. As long as they're making baby steps, as long as air travel doesn't go away, too bad, then the business should recover. And when it does, it should be in the 350 range in a decade for sure. And it's a double digit IRR over time. I think it's a solid investment. So I'm gonna go ahead and give it a good. I think, as discussed, you've got top line revenue growth, earnings growth, strong key free cash flow. Debt is manageable. Now it's too high, doesn't meet our 3x criteria because of these reasons we've discussed, but I think the stock price has been hammered enough to where it compensates you for taking on a little bit more leverage on a deal. So I think that's good. Let me see if I've updated the tranche here. Is this right? No. That's better. So let's look at what happens if I buy the stock at different prices. As it goes up, the return drops off quickly and it's no longer a double digit. So it's kind of, this video is a little late. I should have done it earlier. I got bogged down a lot of other work, so many stocks to look at. But as it rises, it's really going to cap its return. I think the opportunity is if it dips again for some reason, you could get back in. But right now, I think it's a good buy. If it were to come back into the 150 range, fantastic opportunity. As it approaches above 200, I would be passing. I think there's other opportunity out there. But for right now, it's a good investment. Thank you very much for watching the presentation on Boeing. I really enjoyed doing it. I love studying the company. I think it's a fantastic company and a very attractive investment at this point. My name is Cameron Stewart, CFA. This is Rational Investing. Please comment. Let me know what else you'd like to see. And don't forget to hit the subscribe button. Thank you very much. Bye-bye.